Bible study. We are so glad you decided to tune in and watch tonight. We've got a new set. We're right here in the lobby of Lakewood Church. And if you've never visited our church, we'd love for you to come by sometime and see us. But we're excited about continuing our study of 1 Thessalonians. And tonight we're going to study chapter 5. But before we do that, let's start with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the opportunity just to gather together as your people. Lord, even though we're gathering virtually, you said, where any two of us are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of us. Lord, thank you that you're right here with us. And Lord, thank you for the opportunity to read and study your word. Thank you that your word is alive and powerful. And Father, it can change our lives. It can feed our spirits. It can help us grow. We pray, Father, that tonight you would give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we could know you better. That's our goal, Father, to know you better. We pray, Father, that you would take what is hidden in your word and reveal it to us, that we would have a spirit of revelation and enlightenment tonight. Lord, I pray you'd be with every person that's within the sound of my voice, that you would bless, encourage, strengthen, lift, help, Father, comfort, whatever they need, Father, that you would be there as their provider even tonight, Lord. Father, we still our minds and we open our hearts, and we pray, Father, that our minds would be open and receptive, and our hearts would be open and receptive and obedient to everything that you'd have for us tonight, Father. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, I hope as we study this chapter tonight that you'll actually open your Bible and maybe get a pen and notebook out or take some notes on your iPad or your phone, because we're really just going to study this chapter tonight. This chapter is divided into four sections. The first section being a continuation of the teaching about the rapture of the church from chapter 4. Lisa's talked about that. And then instructions about our attitudes toward our spiritual leaders in the church. Then further instructions about our Christian life. And then lastly, Paul's salutation to the people there in Thessalonica. The first part of chapter 5 is a continuation of the thought that Paul is making at the end of chapter 4, where he's talking about the rapture of the church. Lisa taught this last week, but I wanted to review it again this week. The word rapture is not mentioned in the New Testament. So how do we get that word? The phrase caught up together that we'll see in just a minute comes from the Greek word harpazo. And the Latin translation of harpazo is the word rapio, from which we get the word rapture. Rapture means to be carried away or snatched away in spirit or body. So let's review that. Caught up together is the Greek word harpazo. Latin, the translation of that word harpazo in Latin is rapio, from which we get the English word rapture. And it means to be snatched away or carried away in body or spirit. This same word is used in Acts 8:39. The scripture says, "The Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away." That's harpazo. "And the eunuch did not see him again. Philip, however, appeared at Azotus and traveled about preaching the gospel in all the towns until he reached Caesarea." You see, he was carried away from one place to another. In 2 Corinthians 12, Paul talks about being caught up, that's the word harpazo, to the third heaven. Again, he was carried away from one place on the earth to the third heaven. And then in the passage that we're studying tonight, 1 Thessalonians 4:17, the scripture says, "We who are still alive and are left will be caught up, harpazo, together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." In other words, the rapture of the church means the carrying away or the snatching away of the church from the earth to heaven. The rapture of the church is different. It's a different event than the second coming of the Lord. This was very confusing to me for a while, and I wanted to take a look at this tonight. I have a graphic that I think helps explain the timeline. If you look at this graphic, you can see on the far left, note the ascension of Jesus with the arrow pointing up. This is when Jesus left the Mount of Olives and went back up to heaven. And then right beside that is the descent of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, indicated by the arrow coming down. Then there's this oval indicating the church age that we're living in right now, also called the age of the Gentiles, where Gentiles have the opportunity to receive the gospel. Then at the very end of the church age, the age of the Gentiles, note there the rapture of the church indicated by the arrow going up. That's what we're going to talk about tonight. But just after the rapture of the church, and actually the rapture of the church actually begins this next period called the 7 years of tribulation. And this will be a time on the earth where there'll be intense suffering, terrible suffering. Included in the tribulation is when the wrath of God is poured out on the earth. Then note at the end of the 7 years of the tribulation is the second coming of Jesus. This is the arrow going down at the end of the tribulation. This is where Jesus will physically come back to the earth again to establish His kingdom just before the 1,000-year millennial reign of Jesus. With that in mind, let's start reading chapter 4, verse 15, as Paul teaches us about the rapture of the church. The parentheses that you'll see in the scriptures are mine just for clarification. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive and are left till the coming of the Lord, referring to the rapture of the church, will certainly not precede those who've fallen asleep, those who've died. For the Lord Himself will come down from heaven with a loud command and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together, there's the word harpazo, with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Now with that thought comes chapter 5, and Paul continues that thought as we begin chapter 5. Let's read it together. Now brothers and sisters, about times and dates we do not need to write you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord, the rapture, will come like a thief in the night. When people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them. Note that. Suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, they will not escape. Note that Paul doesn't say we here. He says them and they. He's talking about those who've not trusted Jesus as their Savior, those who did not go up in the rapture, those who are still on earth and facing the tribulation. Let's go on to read. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then let us not be like others who are asleep. Now here Paul means spiritually lethargic or insensitive or unaware. But instead, let's be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober as we wait for the day of the Lord, the rapture, putting on faith. Here he goes into a metaphor of a soldier, putting on faith as the love and breastplate covering our hearts, and the hope of salvation as our helmet covering our minds. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, talking about in the tribulation, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that whether we're awake, still alive when He returns, or asleep, already dead when He returns, we may live together with Him. Then Paul concludes this section by saying, therefore, encourage one another and build each other up just as in fact you are doing. You know, as I read this, I noticed in this passage five practical points that I think we can learn from this particular passage of Scripture. The first is this. As believers, we should be looking forward to and eagerly awaiting the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, the rapture of the church. You see, as from that graphic, the rapture of the church is the next major event in the history of the church. So it should not surprise us. We should not only be expecting it, but we should be looking forward to it. You know, a great example of this is my mom. Whenever my mom makes plans, she'll say, well, I'm going to do this next week. But you never know, Jesus may come before then. You see, that's just a great example to me to be expecting and be anticipating, be looking forward to the rapture of the church being snatched up with Jesus to go to live with Him in heaven forever. You know, I have a friend from Kenya who told me this story. There was an older lady who lived in a remote village. She'd been a follower of Jesus for many years. One day she was out gathering water for her family. It just so happened that the Air Force was doing some training in the area, and one of the soldiers had parachuted out of a plane. She had never seen this before. When she looked up in the sky and saw a man coming down out of the clouds, she thought immediately that this was Jesus, and she immediately raised her arms waiting for Jesus to take her to heaven with Him. You see, friends, that should be our posture. We should be eagerly awaiting the Lord's return. Look at some of the scriptures that emphasize this point. In Philippians 3:20, Paul says, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." Then in 1 Corinthians 1:7, he says this, so that you are not lacking in any gift, awaiting eagerly the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then in Titus 2:13, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, the great God and Savior Christ Jesus. Paul calls the return of Jesus, the rapture of the church, our blessed hope. And then in 1 Thessalonians 1, 9 and 10, Paul says this, "They tell us how you turn from God to idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, that is Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath to come." And then at the very end of the Bible, in the book of Revelations, the last words that Jesus said to the church was this, "Yes, I am coming soon." And the response that the church has had for generations now, think about this, 2,000 years, the response of the church has been, "Amen, come Lord Jesus, Maranatha, come Lord Jesus." So from these passages of Scripture, we can see that we should eagerly await Jesus' return. We should be looking forward to His return. And our attitude should just be like that lady in Kenya. Our arms should be up and we should be saying, "Come, Lord Jesus." The second point I want to make from that first passage is this. We should be spiritually sober and alert as we await Jesus' return and not be spiritually lethargic or insensitive or lose our passion. We should live lives that are pleasing to God, lives of excellence while we await His return. We should be faithful to God, doing what He's asked us to do as we wait for His return. So many parables that Jesus told were about watching and waiting for His return and about being faithful while we await His return. And that is how we should be alert, sober, passionate, living lives of excellence, and ready for His return. We should also be living lives full of faith, hope, and love as we await His return. Paul mentions this in this passage. We should have faith and love as our breastplate, covering our heart. We should have the hope of salvation as our helmet, covering our minds. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13, "Now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love." You see, friends, that should characterize the life of a Christian, faith, hope, and love. The fourth point is this. We don't have to worry about suffering God's wrath because He has provided salvation for us through Jesus. Friends, this is such a comforting thought. One of the commentators that I read about this particular passage had this great quote, and I wanted to share it with you. Here's this quote, "As God vents His anger against those on the earth during the tribulation, the body of Christ will be in heaven." Those are comforting words that when all the tribulations taking place on the earth, the body of Christ will be safe with Jesus in heaven because of the salvation He's provided for us. And then the fifth point is this. We should encourage and build each other up with these words. We should remind each other of these great truths that Paul has mentioned here. The hope we have, knowing that very soon Jesus will come and take us to heaven to be with Him forever. Encourage each other to stay alert and sober, to live lives that are pleasing to God, to live with faith, hope, and love as characterizing our lives. And then to encourage and build each other up with the fact that we will not suffer wrath, but instead we will be saved. Then Paul shifts gears and he gives instructions on how to treat those who are in spiritual leadership among us. Look at verses 12 and 13. "Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who take care of you in the Lord and who admonish you or correct you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other." Note, good spiritual leaders should work hard among you, should care for you, and should admonish you or correct you. And then Paul tells us in this passage that our response to their good leadership should be to acknowledge them and the work that they're doing and the way that they care for us, hold them in the highest regard, and do everything we can do to live in peace and harmony and unity as we follow their leaderships. See, friends, this is really important that we treat those in spiritual leadership above us with honor and respect and be thankful for them and their leadership. And sometimes we do have issues with those in leadership. And if we do have an issue with those in spiritual leadership above us, we should pray about it, perhaps go to them and discuss our concerns with them in private. But here's the key. Don't criticize them. Don't undermine their leadership or cause strife or division because God doesn't honor that particular type of behavior. I like the way the Passion Translation says these two verses. "Dear brothers and sisters, make sure that you show your deep appreciation for those who cherish you and diligently work as ministers among you. For they are your leaders who care for you, teach you, and stand before the Lord on your behalf. They value you with great love. Because of their service to you, let peace reign among yourselves. You know, I think on a side note that this is something that we do very well here at Lakewood. We honor and respect and acknowledge the leadership that we have in spiritual leadership above us. And I think this is one of the reasons that God continues to bless us as a church. Now look at verses 14 and 15. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. I think this is a beautiful passage that provides such great practical instruction, little nuggets on how to live our Christian life. We're first to warn those who are idle and disruptive, warn them to get busy, warn them not to cause strife and division. And then we're to encourage those that are discouraged and disheartened, lift those that are downcast, help those that are weak. Don't judge them or condemn them for making mistakes or not being as strong in the faith as you are. Instead, help them. I'm reminded of Paul's words in Romans 15:1. We who are strong should bear with the failings of the weak. Not condemn them, but bear with them and help them. Paul goes on to say that we need to be patient with everyone. Not only just those that are in the community of faith, but patient with everyone. And to make sure we don't pay back wrong for wrong. One commentator I read this week said, non-retaliation for personal wrongs is perhaps the best evidence of personal Christian maturity. I like that. The ability to overlook an insult or an offense, the ability to return good for evil, the ability to walk in love even when people are being unloving toward us is perhaps the best evidence of being a mature Christian. So Paul's encouraging us to have that particular behavior. Then Paul concludes this passage by encouraging us to strive to do what is good to all people that are in our lives, not just in the church family, but also everyone we meet. I was thinking about one of the fruits of the Spirit we rarely talk about is goodness. You know, that's what Paul's talking about here. And David says it succinctly in Psalm 37, trust in the Lord and then do good. We should do our best to do good to every person in our lives every day of our lives. Then verse 16, rejoice always. Other translation says, be joyful always. Be happy and rejoice and glad-hearted continually. Be cheerful no matter what. You see, friends, our joy isn't based on our circumstances. Our joy is based on the fact that we're in the palm of God's hand. He's watching over us. He's providing for us. He's defending us. He's with us. Our names are written in heaven. Heaven is our eternal destiny. The Scripture tells us in Nehemiah that the joy of the Lord is our strength. It's so important that we not lose our joy, because when we lose our joy, we lose our strength. But the corollary is also true. When we keep our joy, when we're joyful in all times, you know what? We keep our strength. We have strength at all times. This is a choice we have to make daily. You have to make it and I have to make it. You know, it's easy to be negative, but we have to choose every day to be joyful every day, despite our circumstances. And then verse 17, another little short passage, pray continually. I like this quote I read. This does not mean some sort of nonstop prayer, but a constantly recurring prayer growing out of a settled attitude of dependence on God. I like that. Growing out of a settled attitude of dependence on God. We can invite God into every part of our lives through prayer. We can let Him know that we're dependent on Him for everything we do in prayer. All through the day, we can talk to Him. Again, that's prayer. Father, give me the right words to say in this conversation. Give me wisdom to know how to respond. Help me to resist this temptation. Help me not to take offense. Give me strength in this difficult situation. As people come in and out of our lives during the day, we can pray for the people we come in contact with that day. You see, we can invite God into every part of our lives through prayer, a continual dependence on God through prayer. One of the things that's really helped me is this. Anytime I'm tempted to worry about something, I choose to pray about it instead. I can turn my worry list into my prayer list. How many of you know every day we have so many things that we can worry about, and that just gives us a prompt to pray instead. I love the scripture in Philippians 4. Do not be anxious about anything. Paul says, don't be anxious about one thing, but in everything, every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And then there's a benefit to that. When we do that, when we turn our worry list into our prayer list, then the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. So that's Paul's encouragement. Pray continually. And then verse 18, he says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Notice he says, give thanks in all circumstances and not for all circumstances. Let me give you just four quick thoughts on giving thanks. Number one is this: no matter how bad it gets, no matter how hard it gets, friends, there's always something to be grateful for. Always something to be grateful for. I remember when my dad called me one day and he asked me, he had his kidneys were not doing well and he had all of his lab tests, and he said, Paula, I want you to look at these lab tests and I want you to tell me what they all mean. I said, okay, Daddy, not only will I look at them, I'll take them to one of my nephrologist friends and I'll call you back and we'll talk about the results. And I'll never forget, he called back a few days later and I had to break the news to him. I said, Daddy, you know what, unfortunately, the trajectory of your kidney function is declining and declining and declining, and you're going to have to be on dialysis within 6 months. You know, friends, that would be devastating news for me. But I'll never forget what my dad did. He said, Paul, thank you for the information, but thank God Jesus is still on the throne. You see, friends, he had bad news, but he chose to be grateful for something, because we always have something to be grateful for. The second point is this: don't have to lose something to be grateful for it. Not long ago, the hot water heater in our house that supplies water to our shower went out. You know what? Let me say this. It took them a couple of days to repair it. And so for a couple of days, I had to take a cold shower. But the point is, I wasn't grateful for warm water. I just took it for granted until I didn't have it. Let me give you another example. When I practiced surgery, sadly, often I had to break news to families that they had just lost their loved ones in an accident. I remember sharing so many tears with these families. We would have the conversation in a small family room right there inside the emergency room. I made it a point every day when I left the hospital in the evening to walk through the emergency room and walk right past that little room, just to remind myself that life is fragile, life is uncertain, and you never know how long you have with someone, and to be grateful for those people in our lives. You see, friends, don't have to lose something to be grateful for it. Third point is this: I found that the more grateful I am, the more I have to be grateful for. I don't know how it happens. I don't know if God gives me more things to be grateful for, or all of a sudden my lens is just attentive and looking for things to be grateful for. But the more grateful I am, the more I have to be grateful for. The fourth point is this: some of the most joy-filled people I know are the most grateful people I know. You see, there's a direct correlation between joy and gratitude. Here's the thing, though. Being thankful and grateful is not our natural tendency. It's not our default setting. Our flesh, our sinful nature, will naturally tend to be negative and find fault and complain. We have to resist this natural tendency and learn to be grateful. See, I'm convinced that gratitude is something that has to be learned. It's a habit that we form. Let's go on to verse 19 and 20 through 22. Do not put out the Spirit's fire. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good and reject what is harmful. In 1 Corinthians 12, Paul tells us about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, one of which is the gift of prophecy. Prophecy is when the Holy Spirit moves on someone to give another person a word of edification, exhortation, comfort, or sometimes a warning. Let me say that again. It's where the Holy Spirit comes on someone to give a person a word of edification, exhortation, comfort, or sometimes warning. Apparently, people were using their spiritual gift of prophecy in their worship services, but the Thessalonian believers were minimizing or discounting or looking down on these prophecies. Here Paul is telling them, don't put out the Spirit's fire. Don't treat prophecies with contempt, but instead to test them. Hold on to what is from God and reject what is not. In verse 23 and 24, he goes on to say, may God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you, make you holy, in other words, through and through. May your whole spirit and soul and body, your whole being, be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Look at how Jude says this same thought. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord. Think about it. We will be blameless and without fault when we stand before Jesus. Think about that, blameless and without fault, because the one who calls us is faithful and he will do it. Then finally, in verses 25 through 28, Paul goes on to say, brothers and sisters, pray for us. Greet all God's people with a holy kiss. I charge you before the Lord to have this letter read to all the brothers and sisters. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. You know, it was common in this culture to greet friends with a kiss on the cheek. The men greeted other men this way, and the women did with other women. By urging this practice, Paul was encouraging an outward physical expression of the true Christian love that believers have for each other. A kiss is also a sign of affection shared among family members as a token of their close relationship. Christians are a part of the family of God. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. Paul is encouraging the believers to treat each other like they were the same family. Maybe today it's a handshake or a hug, or maybe it is a kiss on the cheek. But here's the bottom line is that we are to greet each other as dear friends and as dear family. Then Paul ends the letter, like he does every one of his letters, with these words, the grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. The grace of God was Paul's greatest delight, and he wanted each and every one of his readers to experience this same grace. That concludes the first letter to the believers in Thessalonica. Let me remind you of just a few of the great passages and great thoughts that we've studied tonight. Let's eagerly await the Lord Jesus when He comes for us to take us to heaven with Him forever in the rapture. Let's remember that God has not appointed us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's treat those in spiritual leadership above us with the utmost respect and honor, and do everything we can to live in peace and unity under their leadership. Let's encourage the discouraged. Let's help the weak. Let's be patient with everyone. Let's make sure we return good for evil. Let's be joyful always, pray continually, and give thanks in every situation. Let's remember that one day, friends, we will stand before Jesus and we will be blameless and without fault, all because of what Jesus has done for us and because the one who calls us is faithful and he will do it. If you receive that, would you say amen? All right, let me just pray. Father, thank you for the words that we've received, Lord. I just thank you for the powerful words that you've imparted to our spirits and to our hearts tonight. Lord, I pray that we would be not only hearers of the word, we would not only be receptive, but Father, we would be doers of the word as well. Teach us from this. Help us to grow. Help us to become more like you. Father, we thank you for the blessed hope that we have in our Lord Jesus Christ and his return. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, friends, we hope you'll join us this next weekend for our services here at Lakewood, and see you next Monday night, hopefully. God bless you. We love you, and we pray for you every day.